Good morning to all. In today's session, we are going to start with CSIR NET GRF Chemical Science, June 2015, Part C, Series 6, where we are going to cover 10 questions of this series, right? So earlier we completed 2016, 17, 18, 19, 20 academic year question papers of both June and December sessions, and entire detailed solved question papers, which are available on the channel called World of Competitive Chemistry. This kind of standard question paper discussion will help you for further preparation towards any competitive exams and any further entrance examinations, right? So it will help you for analyzing question paper weightage, from which section more number of questions are coming, what will be the pattern of question paper, and what will be the question framing, entire things will be analyzed. So this is very much helpful. Let us enter into our actual concept. So here, CSIR NET GRF Chemical Science, June 2015, Part C, Series 6 consists of question number 121 to 130. Let us discuss about today's concept. The molecular orbital of diatomic molecule changes sign when it is rotated by 180 degrees around a molecular axis. The orbital is... Okay, so here molecular orbital is considered for diatomic molecules. For molecular orbital, it is denoted with sigma, phi, delta, and phi. So if L value is 0, that is called the sigma orbital. L value is 1, that is denoted with pi orbital. L value is 2, denoted with delta. L value is 3, phi orbital will be there. These are the representation of molecular orbitals. Atomic orbitals are denoted with S, P, D, F. Molecular orbitals are denoted with sigma, pi, delta, and phi orbitals will be there. What they are asking for? So when we are rotating about 180 degrees, their sign will be changed. If initially positive is there, by rotating 180, it will become negative. So in that way, where you can find, when you are taking sigma, sigma denotes what? S type of orbital. S orbital will be spherical in nature. If spherical orbital rotated 180, is there any change in sign? There is no possibility. That's the reason why sigma will not be employed. When we are taking pi orbital is denoted with the two lobes. Two lobes when we are interchanging 180 degrees. So flipping 180 degrees, what happens? Positive will become negative and negative will become positive. Interchange, it's a sign, so that by rotating 180 degrees, pi orbital is possible, right? So pi bonding is unchanged, and it is the employed, it is employed for this question. And when we take molecular orbitals of diatomic molecule, delta and phi kind of orbitals may not be visible. Only sigma bonding, sigma antibonding, pi bonding, pi antibonding type of orbitals are available for diatomic molecule. They already mentioned diatomic molecule, only we have to go with the sigma and pi. So delta and phi orbitals may not be available here, right? In case of sigma and pi, sigma orbital, there is no chance, because being it is the spherical, there is no possibility to assign any sign for this one. So only the option is pi ungeared orbital, that is nothing but pi bonding orbital when 180 degrees rotated. So it will change its sign. For question number 121, option number 2 is the correct answer. Let us move on to question number 122. This is the part of IR active normal modes. This is a part of group theory. IR active normal modes of methane belongs to the irreducible representations. Okay, so here this is the table, character table was provided, and the X, Y, Z coordinate terms also provided. These are the symmetry operations performed for these many irreducible representations, and it is the point group, tetrahydral point group is provided. Being it is methane, always tetrahydral symmetry will be present for this one. And this is the what a solution table for that one. And R is given as 15, 0, minus 1, minus 1, 3, right? R is given as, for methane, R is given as 15, 0, minus 1, minus 1, 3. The possible symmetry operations are identity element, 8 C3 axis of symmetry, 3 C2 axis of symmetry, 6 S4 axis, and 6 sigma D axis of diagonal plane of symmetry is also present. and these many reducible representations are provided for this one. So after multiplying, after calculating all the individual values for A1, A2, ET1, T2 irreducible representations. So here we will get 10113. 10113 is obtained. So that can be, there is a possibility of, and here we will get R for methane is given as it is the sum of A1 plus E plus T1 plus 3T2. A1 plus E plus T1 plus 3T2 can be taken, whose value is given as 15, 0, minus 1, minus 1, 3, right? So now, from this table, translational and rotational forms of reduced representations, 3N. So 3N denotes what? So 3 denotes what? One is translational, second is rotational, third is vibrational. That's why 3 is denoted. 3N to obtain the symmetry of the vibrational modes. Right, we have to subtract the translational and the rotational forms from reduced representation so that the molecule having same symmetry as the translational motion. So wherever translational motion is there, that value is obtained after subtracting translational plus rotational from reduced representations. Okay, so final answer will be translational motion. So that is given in the option number 4. So for question number 122, option number 4 is the correct answer, right? So this is the solved table, and we have to go with subtracting the translational plus rotational values from reduced representations. The value obtained is a translational motion. Translational motion is provided in option number 4. So for question number 122, option number 4 is the correct answer. Let us move on to question number 123. Again, it is the part of group theory. The symmetric rotor among the following, which is called symmetric rotor. Let us see. Symmetric rotor is nothing but, so two moments of inertia are equal but different from third one. Moment of inertia for x coordinate and y coordinate will be identical, but it will be contradictory with another z coordinate. Then you can say that is said to be a symmetric rotor. Okay. So moment of inertia in two dimensions will be equal. With the third dimension, it will be contradictory. So in that case, you can say the molecule is symmetric rotor. Molecule belongs to the category include ammonia, benzene, and chloromethane are the category of symmetric rotors. So within the options, chloromethane is given. So methyl chloride is given. This is the correct option. Ammonia, benzene, and chloromethane are the example for symmetric rotors. Let us discuss in detail. A unique axis of molecule about which moment of inertia is different is said to be IP. IP denotes what? Principal axis. Okay. Where the, here already we discussed, in two dimensions, moment of inertia is same. In any other dimension, moment of inertia is different. Where the moment of inertia is different, that is taken as the principal axis. And the moment of inertia, that will be contradictory with remaining two. The molecule above, it would be parallel to CCl bond. So CCl bond, that principal axis. So we can place the principal axis in this direction, right? We shall designate moment of inertia about principal axis as IP. And another two axes are denoted with I naught. I naught of two axes. So I naught of remaining two axes will remain same, right? So that is given in the chloromethane. Chloromethane is option number 2. For question number 123, option number 2 is the correct answer. Let us move on to question number 124. It is a part of spectroscopic analytical method, right? Nuclear G factor for proton and N14 are given as 5.6 and 0.40 respectively. G factor value for proton and N14 both are provided here. If the magnetic field in NMR spectrometer is set to such that proton resonates at 700, so proton frequency is given, nitrogen frequency to be calculated. Okay, so G factor is provided. And frequency value of proton is provided, frequency value of nitrogen 14, at which frequency it will resonate, that should be predicted. For that purpose, we have the formula. Condition for resonance is given as nu is equal to gamma b naught to 2 pi. nu denotes what? Frequency at which the instrument is operated. For proton, it is operated at 700, right? For nitrogen to be determined. Gamma is denoted as a gyromagnetic ratio. Gamma denotes what? Gyromagnetic ratio. And B naught is nothing but intensity of the magnetic field strength what we are applying. Magnetic field strength is denoted with B naught, 2 pi, this is the integer value, right? So this is a formula for the determination of frequency at which the instrument is resonating. Okay, so here, and there is another relation. This frequency also proportional to the factor G, right? So G factor for nitrogen and proton both are provided within the problem itself. And there is an empirical, formula and a direct relation between G factor and frequency that is given by GH by GN is equal to VH by VN. GH denotes what? G factor of hydrogen by G factor of nitrogen is equal to resonance frequency of hydrogen by resonance frequency of nitrogen. Hydrogen G factor denoted with 5.6. Nitrogen will be 0.4 and frequency of proton at which it resonates is 700. Nitrogen yet to be determined, so that we designated with X. So here Vn is required to be calculated. So that's the reason why Vn is equal to 700 into 0.4 by 5.6. If we do the calculation, the resonance frequency of nitrogen 14 is given as 50 megahertz. What is the value? 50 megahertz. At this frequency, this nitrogen will resonate. 50 megahertz provided in the option number 4. For question number 124, option number 4 is the correct answer. Let us move on to question number 125. Again, it is a part of analytical spectroscopy. The spectroscopic technique by which ground state dissociation energies of diatomic molecules can be estimated. Dissociation energies are mainly calculated by the spectroscopy, where vibrational frequency can be employed. Vibrational spectroscopy can be employed, and the formula will be dE is equal to omega y minus xe square into 4xe. This is a formula for the determination of dissociation energy. dE denotes what? Dissociation energy. It is calculated by the formula omega into 1 minus xe square into 4xe. So this is purely based on what? Vibrational spectroscopy, alternatively known as infrared spectroscopy. So dissociation energy is calculated purely by infrared spectroscopy. For question number 125, option number 2 is the correct answer. Let us move on to question number 126. It is a part of group theory again. The term symbol for the first excited state of beryllium electronic configuration 1s2, 2s1, 3s1. So ground level configuration will be 1s2, 2s2. But when we excite, if first excited level was given, that is 1s2, 2s1, 3s1 will be given. So in this case, what will be the term symbol? So 2s1, 3s1 can be taken. For 2s1, 3s1, what is the S value? Spin. So one electron spin will be half. Half plus half. So total spin will become 1. Spin is equal to 1. Then what is spin multiplicity? Spin multiplicity formula will be 2 into S plus 1. 2 into 1 plus 1. 2 into 1, 2. 2 plus 1, it will become 3. Spin multiplicity is calculated as 3. Then let us predict the L value. Where the electron resides? Electron present in S orbital. S orbital, angular momentum value will be 0. Here also 3s orbital, angular momentum value again becomes 0. 0 plus 0, it will become 0 itself, right? L value becomes 0 for both the orbitals. Okay, so now J value. So J value, we have two conditions, less than half filled L minus S, more than half filled or half filled L plus S. S orbital maximum capacity will be 2 electrons. 2s1 is there, here also 2s1. These are denoted as half filled orbitals. For half filled, J value will be taken as L plus S. L value is 1, sorry, L value is 0, S value is 1. 0 plus 1, it will become 1 only. J value is 1 only, right? So here superscript spin multiplicity value will be 3 and angular momentum value 0. 0 denotes what? S orbital. 0 denotes S orbital. So that S is the term symbol and J, L plus S. 0 plus 1, it will be 1. 3S, 1 is the term symbol for beryllium excited level. 3S1 provided in option number 1. For 126 question, option number 1 is the correct answer. So this is the term symbol question. Now let us move on to question number 127. Which of the following statement is incorrect? What is the incorrect statement? This is purely based on quantum mechanics. So this question came from quantum mechanics. Slater determinant question was given, right? So in quantum mechanics, Slater determinant is the expression which describes the wave function of multi-Fermi ionic system. Fermi ions are the smaller subatomic particles. So electron is also part of Fermi ion only. So multi-Fermi ion system present, then only we can apply this Slater determinant. And it satisfies anti-symmetry requirement. Anti-symmetry when present within the molecule, then it is applicable Slater determinant. Consequently, Pauli's exclusion can be employed by this one. And changing sign upon change of two electrons. So when two electrons were taken, they are able to change their sign. So this can be applied for multi-Fermi ionic system. And when two electrons got considered, their spin state will be varied. Okay. So these are the statements which these are the actual predictions for Slater determinant. So based on this, let us see which are incorrect statements. Slater determinant is an anti-symmetrized wave function is the correct one. Electronic wave function should be represented by Slater determinant, also correct one, because Fermi ions, in that Fermi ion, electron is also part, so that electronic wave function is also correct answer. Slater determinant always corresponds to a particular spin state is wrong. When two electrons got considered, their spin state will be varied. Their spin state will be changed. So here, particular spin state is the wrong statement. A Slater determinant obeys Pauli's exclusion is the correct answer. Pauli's exclusion, it will obey Pauli's exclusion principle. Except option number 3, all are the correct statements. We have to predict what is the incorrect. For question number 127, option number 3 is the correct answer. Let us move on to question number 128. Compare the difference energies of first excited ground state energy of a particle confined in one-dimensional, two-dimensional and three-dimensional box. One dimensional denoted with delta 1, two dimensional energy delta 2, three dimensional energy delta 3. Assume length of each box is same. Each box length is same. The correct relation between energy differences to be predicted, delta 1, delta 2, delta 3 energy differences we need to predict. For that purpose, one dimensional box energy denoted with E1 is equal to n square pi square h square by 2 ml square. For two dimensional, it will be n1 square plus n2 square pi square h square by 2 ml square. For three dimensional, n1 square plus n2 square plus n3 square pi square h square by 2 ml square. These are the formulas for one dimensional, two dimensional, three dimensional respectively, right? So that is tabulated here. For one-dimensional, two-dimensional, and three-dimensional box, it is possible to compare in the tabular form representation. Ground level for one-dimensional will be 1. Ground level for two-dimensional will be n1 is equal to 1, n2 is equal to also 1. And ground level for third also, at ground level, all three-dimensional box, n1, n2, n3 values are 1 only. Then when we excite first level, n is equal to 2 for one-dimensional, N1 is equal to 2, N2 is equal to 1 for 2-dimensional, 1, 1, 1 for 3-dimensional box. If we see the energy difference, when we substitute these values, N values when substituted in these equations, when we take the energy difference, how can we get energy difference? Energy difference is nothing but excited level energy, that is nothing but E1 minus E0. Energy level difference between two consecutive energy levels can be taken, that is denoted with delta. So delta 1 for one dimensional, delta 2 for two dimensional, delta 3 for three dimensional. Just we have to substitute the values of n here, right? N values can be substituted. After substituting n values for one dimensional, the energy difference between E1 and E2 is taken as 3 pi square h square by 2 ml square. Energy difference for two-dimensional also given as 3 pi square h square by 2 ml square. for three dimensional 3 pi square h square by 2 ml square. So when you observe the energy differences for all three particles here exactly same. That means even though individual energies are different, but energy difference for one dimensional, two dimensional, three dimensional boxes will be equal. So that is provided in option number 2. For question number 128, option number 2 is the correct answer. Let us move on to question number 129. The correct statement about the both average values of position and momentum of one dimensional harmonic oscillator wave function is position momentum related question it is. So here, correct statement about the average value of position and momentum. So if we are taking x and x cube, that is nothing but odd values are taken for x. So x denotes what? Position. If odd values are given, if you are taking odd values for x, so x to the power 1 here, x to the power 3 here, in that case the value becomes a 0. Then if we are having x to the power even value, then it will become non-zero. If it is a power 1 or 3, any odd value is there, that in that case x value becomes a 0. But in case of wave function psi, so even though it may be odd or even, the value may be positive or negative. If it is a peak, the value will be denoted with positive. If it is a trough, the value is denoted with negative. So that may be odd or even, so both the values are possible. But when we take the square of this one, mod psi square was taken, always that value becomes even. How it can be? So because we are squaring that, right? By squaring that one, always it will become even value only. So integral of odd power of x by squaring the wave function. So integral, when we are taking the integral of x and psi, always it will become zero, obviously, right? So in that case, x is equal to zero, and even this position or momentum of the given particle also becomes a zero, because when we are taking squaring the wave function and also odd power of the x will be taken. So x to the power 1 is there, so that here the value of x becomes 0, subsequently value of momentum also becomes a 0, right? For question number 129, option number 3 is the correct answer. Let us move on to last question of the series. The value of the commutator x px is given as x into xpx is given as, right? The commutator value is given as xp is equal to ih. This is a fundamental equation. What is the equation? Xp is equal to ih cut. Then commutator x comma ih is given as 0, because any commutator multiplied with the function, then the value becomes a 0, right? So value becomes a 0. So here 0 is the correct answer, because here within the problem they mentioned x into xpx can be taken. So here, so we are multiplying with the function, so that commutator is the constant value. When it multiplied with the function, the entire value becomes a 0. That is provided in option number 4. For question number 130, option number 4 is the correct answer. By this, series number 6 pertaining the questions from 121 to 130 have been completed. So hope this session will be helpful for you. Thank you very much for your patience listening. Thank you, one and all.